Are you working on your author career but struggling to get that first book published? Does the goal of being an author seem too lofty? Or are thoughts of having multiple books and making a full-time living are as fantastical as living in Cinderella's castle? Welcome to Discovered Wordsmiths, a podcast where aspiring authors can be heard. Join Stephen Schneider as he finds and talks to authors you may not know, but authors that have gotten their foot on the author career path. Hear what they've done to get there and where they want to go now. Settle back. It's time for a bit of inspiration and advice. Come listen to today's Discovered Wordsmith.
Well, let's start off. First of all, sure. We met at Jay Thorne's weekend retreat. So anyone listening to the podcast, look up Jay Thorne. He's doing a mastermind. He does weekend retreats. He's got books out. Jay's a great guy. Another Northeast Ohio native. So, Mark, before we get started on books and writing, tell us a little bit about you. Who are you? Where you're from? Whatever you think would be interesting and relevant.
Sure. I'm Mark Roman. I split my time between homes in Northeast Ohio and Virginia. My wife is an archaeologist, so that's always fun to hear some of the stories that she has about some of the digs she volunteers for. Historic Jamestown in Jamestown, Virginia, and she also volunteers for the Colonial Williamsburg Foundation. So she's always got some fun stories from a historical perspective. And so I'm originally born in Cleveland and raised in Warren, Ohio, which is also in Northeast Ohio. I went to Case Western Reserve University here in the Cleveland area. And after school, immediately moved to New York and lived in New York for a few years, New York City, and have always been an information technology and business consultant for the past 40 years. It's hard to say 40 years, but it'll be 40 years in 2020 since I graduated from college, and I've had opportunity to live in some really fun places. I lived in Johannesburg, South Africa for a couple of years. I lived in San Francisco for a few years. I lived in Salt Lake City. I lived in Charleston. I lived in London for a couple of years. So I've always had a breadth of experience with the different people and different cultures. And
was all of that for business or
yes.
By choice?
All of that was for business and by choice, because like going to Joburg, to Johannesburg, the United States was still in the process of establishing relationships with the South African government. Apartheid was falling apart, and I was the president of a division of IBM Corporation at the time, and IBM was reestablishing relationships, and I've always been involved in the healthcare industry. So actually, IBM had a philanthropic effort, and we had semis that we had outfitted as mobile clinics, and we drove those semis around South Africa, and we're vaccinating children and giving wellness checkups and antibiotics where antibiotics would be appropriate for different infections and things of that nature.
Wow, and, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah, it was really cool. It was one of those things where, it was a land of haves and haves nots, because I also did work in Soweto, in the townships of South Africa, with Boparacara, which is the largest acute care hospital in the world. There were about 6,000 patients, and it wasn't an AIDS hospital or a chronic care hospital. It's for people that have appendicitis or heart attacks or whatever acute types of conditions, and that was a life-changing experience. And I've always I was adopted, so I've always been wanted a brother or a sister. Never a family couldn't afford another mouth to feed, but it was one of those things where we were poor growing up financially, but oh my God, were we rich with love. My mom was next to the oldest of 12 kids. My dad was the baby of 10. Both of them were depression babies. And so we, you know, I had literally hundreds of cousins, and you know, so it was. But I, as an only child, I learned to make friends quickly, and cherished those friendships because I didn't have kind of built-in friends with brothers and sisters. But that was also the catalyst for my first book, which was just published in October of this year, Conquering the Boundaries of Friendship. It's interesting because about 12 years ago, my best friend, who's 27 years my junior, some of my contemporaries, some of my friends were saying, hey, watch, you know, this kid, why does he want to be friends with you? And, you know, what's he looking for, et cetera. And he and I got to talking about it. And I said, you know, it was kind of surprising to me that my contemporaries were curious why this young guy wanted to be friends with an old guy like me. And he said, Mark, I'm getting the same thing from my friends. Matter of fact, he said a couple of his friends had come up to him and said, hey, watch out. What's this old dude want? You know, why does he want to be your friend? And so we got to talking about it, and I started basically interviewing other friends to find out some of the boundaries that as men have had to cross to either make or maintain friendships. And that was the catalyst for that was the main idea, the main thrust behind the book.
So making this friendship work gave you the idea, and I assume some of your past experience in life fed into that. Was it one of those light bulb moments, like everything suddenly clicked and gelled and you saw it in front of you?
Well, it was, and you know, that was 12 years ago, and I said, my best friend's name is Ben. Ben and I joked. I said, well, I'm going to write a book about that someday. And we, you know, kind of put it on the back shelf. You know, as a consultant, one of the things that I've always done is interview people. And so I got the idea. Well, I posted a request on both Facebook and LinkedIn. And I had about 300 men volunteer to be interviewed for the book. So I interviewed over 300 individuals from 60 different countries. And what was amazing to me, Steve, was the similarities, regardless of what culture you were. The sport may be different, but for example, I have a chapter in the book talking about things that we learn as men, and things like, you know, there's no crying in baseball. You know, man up. Don't be a sissy. Those types of things. And the similarities were just astounding, regardless of what country or individual I interviewed. I remember interviewing a man named Nadim, who was from Bangladesh, and I said, you know, about cultural things that he was learned as a boy, and he said, well, Mark, there's no crying in cricket. and I kind of chuckled and said, there's no crying in cricket? What do you mean, Nadim? He said, oh, my God, Mark, when I was learning to play cricket, you know, my dad and my uncles would be along the sidelines. And if somebody had a bad call from one of the umpires or, you know, somebody should have had a point, and if somebody felt bad about it or started to cry, you know, you got yelled at by your dad and or uncles or whomever saying, hey, no crying in cricket. And it was funny because I interviewed some men from Japan, and their statement was, there's no crying in soccer. and Australians, there's no crying in football. So it was just things of that nature that are cultural, that we are raised with as men. And I'm sure that there are similar things that women are raised with, but I just focused on men. Being a man, this is an area that I know, and certainly it was of interest to me.
So was that the main focus when you started the book, to find men across various social norms and cultures and to see what similarities or differences, and tell everybody, hey, look, we're the same?
Yes, it was. My hypothesis was, as men, regardless of what culture you were in, regardless of your socioeconomic status, that we were raised similarly and have similar baggage when it comes to making or maintaining friendships. And so I literally, you know, interviewed men who were ditch diggers, professional ditch diggers, and by hand and in construction. And I've interviewed CEOs of multi-billion-dollar organizations. And it was shocking, the similarity, although my hypothesis was that we had pretty similar backgrounds. And I have to just thank the over 300 men that I interviewed, because they opened their hearts to me and talked about very difficult situations. I had several men that confided in me that their wives or children had committed suicide or had traumatic physical injury, and how their friends came and supported them. One that was pretty stark that really pops to mind is a man whose wife had committed suicide, and she had been married before, and so this gentleman had a stepson, and he wasn't clear how to how to talk to his stepson about his mother committing suicide. And as a result, he was pretty self-conscious about being alone at home with his son, with his stepson. And he said that a couple of his friends literally showed up at dinner time with a six-pack of beer for he and for them, and a six-pack of root beer for his son, and a pizza. Or they would stop by with pasta or something that they had picked up. And this gentleman would say, well, you know, what are you guys doing here? Well, we're having dinner. And so, you know, it was to soothe the pain and to get closer to him, and to make it easier for his son as well, who had lost his mother. And of course, there's a lot of self-doubt that creeps into all men's and self-criticism of, I should have known something was up. And there were several men that I interviewed who had had children who had committed suicide, who by all accounts, if you looked at their sons or daughters who had committed suicide, they were very successful. They had steady boy or girlfriends. They were sports stars in high school. They were, by all accounts, had everything going for them, but were really suffering some bullying and some things that their parents may not have been aware of. And that ran the gamut. It didn't matter what socioeconomic class you were from. And interestingly, of all of the people, of all the men that I interviewed, socioeconomic class was one boundary that men said that they had to cross. I remember talking to one man who was fairly well-to-do financially, and a sailor, and has a fairly nice yacht in one of the yacht clubs in the Boston area. And there's a maintenance man at his yacht club who's very handy with rigging on boats. And this man who owns the boat asked the maintenance man to help him with some rigging, and he just wanted to take that man out for a beer to say thanks. And the members of the club saw the two at a local pub. The maintenance man said, "Well, you I can't be seen with you at the club. That's strictly against the employment rules." And the next day, the couple of the members had spoken to the commodore of the club. And the commodore approached this man and said, "You're not supposed to be fraternizing with the help." And he said, I'm having a beer with a friend, right? It's not, he works for the club, but, and yes, he's done some work for me, but he hasn't done it on club time. And I like the guy." So they've had to cross socioeconomic barriers and it's interesting, because every man that I talked to said that there wasn't a barrier between them and their friend. The barriers were cultural or societal in nature, of people objecting to a man who's a member of a yacht club being friends with, or having to cross that boundary to be friends with the maintenance man. And there's obviously all sorts of boundaries that men cross when it comes to friendships in the workplace.
So for the book, were you hoping to show that these are, I guess, false in a way, that they're man-made, these thoughts they are, and these norms?
They are false. And the main message coming out of the book was, if you like somebody or you have an attraction to them, and the term attraction I know made some people uncomfortable, but many of the men that I interviewed said that they were attracted to a guy for a number of reasons. So one man said he was attracted to another man because in the restaurant, they were at a common restaurant for over lunchtime, and the man that I interviewed said, "Wow, this guy was polite to everybody. He was fantastic. He was nice to the hostess. He asked the busboy the busboy's name. He treated the servers very pleasantly." And this man said, "You know, I was attracted to this guy because of, number one, his confidence, but number two, how nice he was." And some men said, I was attracted to a man because he had a good body. And one man said, "I know that probably makes people uncomfortable, but I'm trying to get more fit. And as a result, I looked at this guy and said, man, he's got a great body. He obviously at the same gym that I am, and maybe he could give me some pointers." So there is an attraction, a physical attraction. But so, you know, there are a lot of examples of that nature where they are really societal kind of boundaries. They're not boundaries that necessarily exist between the two men, but age difference being one. If you're 60 years old, you can't have a good friend who's 25. That's wrong for whatever reason.
And I find that interesting because, as you said, you're in your 60s.
Yep.
And the world today, my kids are all under the age of 25.
Yep.
And their world is different than ours. You're right.
Yes, it is.
We both grew up, don't be a sissy, you know, be a big boy, that blah blah blah. But now they're much more accommodating and accepting, and it's blurring quite a bit. I just find it, I guess, uplifting. Somebody that's in their 60s can see this and view things more like what the generations coming up are doing. And it's a good thing, the diversity, the acceptance that people are who they are. You know, you can be a guy, you can be a weightlifter, and you could still be sad and cry if your dog dies.
Right.
You know, and I think that's great, seeing different generations being able to change and see that all the way from the kids up through me and up to you. So what would you say, your book, what would you tell somebody, a guy that says, well, what's your book? Why would I read your book other than what you've already told us, which I think would sell the book itself? But is there anything else you wanted to try and get out to tell people, hey, this is why you should read this?
Well, I have a number of calls to action in the book. I have a number of challenges in the book for you to examine relationships that you have today, and how can you be a better friend. So I started doing this probably 20 years ago with a number of my friends. I call it the friendship audit. and I will tell you, it is difficult the first time you do it with somebody, and I prefer to do it in a non-formal setting, like over a beer or having lunch or something. But I sit down with all of my friends at least once a year and just say, okay, Steve, how can I be a better friend this year? And here, let me tell you where I think I was a good friend, but here's areas where I think I could do a better job, where I think I might have failed you. And the first time you do that with your friend, it can be awkward, but I also have some giveaways in the book. If you write to me at ctbfbook@gmail.com, CTBF for Conquering the Boundaries of Freedom, book, all one word, @gmail.com. I have some contracts that I send to people, and I've had some tremendous response with those, of how you're going to be a better friend to somebody over the next year, and contracts with yourself, how you can be a better friend to people in need, and how you can extend yourself. And So it's, you know, and I've had some tremendous feedback, Steve. I had a woman who wrote to me, and I don't know, I didn't know her husband, but she saw the book sitting on her husband's nightstand, and she asked him what it was about, and he said, "Oh, you wouldn't like it. It's about male friendships and men's relationships." And she said, "Okay, well, I'm going to read it." And he said, "Well, whatever." So she wrote to me, and she said, "Mark, I just want to tell you this story. I read your book, and my husband and I sat down, and we've decided that we're going to message our children differently because we're not sure we're messaging them the way we want to. And your book opened our eyes to some of the messages that all of your interviewees said, like, you know, don't be a sissy and big boys don't cry and things of that nature." And she said that we examined some of the messaging that we're leaving with both our boys and our girls. She said we have both boys and girls, and she said your book opened our eyes to how we're raising our kids. And I tell you what, Steve, that kind of feedback is what I wrote the book for. You know, my whole thing was I feel like I have some incredible personal relationships.
And feedback like that, you're right. That's, I mean, any sense of the word, in my mind, you've succeeded. I mean, that's amazing.
Yes. And I, you know, I had emergency brain surgery in January of 2018. And I realized then what a strong tribe of friends that I've got, because I had friends that flew in from California or drove down from Michigan or drove up from Kentucky to make sure that my wife was okay and to help take care of things around the house. And I had one friend who had worked with me at one of the companies that we worked together. And he was able to help me get back on my feet with some of my clients, because clients were writing to me, and I wanted to make sure that somebody who had similar type of background could read my intended responses. And as a result, he read what I was going to send to some of my clients, and he would question me, he would coach me and say, "Is this what you mean to say? Because this is what I think you're saying." And having that tribe of friends, and I am definitely in most business schools today, they teach you not to have deep, meaningful relationships with your clients, and I am a contrarian when it comes to that belief. I think your clients, when you have deep, meaningful relationships with them, business moves at the speed of trust. And if you trust somebody and you know them, you can have a personal relationship, but you can also have a professional relationship, and you both have integrity, and you're both going to follow your procurement rules and all of those types of things. But I of all of the men that I interviewed, I would say that everyone agreed that by having deep, meaningful relationships with their clients or with vendors and coworkers, help to serve them well, both personally and professionally. So it's there's a lot of after my brain surgery.
So let me interrupt you real quick. Yes. Right there, you just casually throw out, "Oh, I had brain surgery."
Yeah.
So, and you said it was an emergency. So I take it. It was definitely needed, and it went well because you're talking to us right now.
Yes.
But do you think that gave you kind of the push to want to write, or
absolutely, absolutely?
If you hadn't had that brain surgery, do you think you would have still wrote this book, or would it still be sitting around in your head?
I think it probably would still be sitting around in my head. Yeah. So I had a birth defect, which was asymptomatic. I never had any symptoms with it, and in January of 2018, it ruptured, so the aneurysm gave me all of the symptoms of a right-side stroke, and I was told at the time that I would I would never walk again. I would be paralyzed the rest of my life, and I would be blind. I would never see again. And, you know, I was...
That doesn't make for a good beginning of the year.
No, it does not. But thank God I was life-flighted to the main campus of Cleveland Clinic. And it's the birth defect that I had is very, very rare. There's about 100 people worldwide that are diagnosed with it on an annual basis. And luckily, the neurosurgeon that was assigned to my case does about 70 of the surgeries on a worldwide basis every year. So my new normal, and you know, so I'm writing my next book is actually, you know, it's one of those things where, I mean, I don't want to sound crass about it, but if I can do it, you can do it.
Well, there's the message. If
yes,
we'll make T-shirts. If Mark can do it, you can do it.
If Mark, you know, talk about turning lemons into lemonade. The next book that I'm writing is called "You're Cured: The Definitive Guide to Caregivers and Patients on the Healing Process," and I've interviewed almost 400 people for that book.
So let me switch gears just a little bit.
Yes.
Is your book self-published, or did you get an agent and go traditional, or how did that work, the more business publishing aspects?
It's hybrid. I'll put it to you that way. I looked at all of the options of kind of self-publishing. I looked at getting an agent. I put together a book proposal, and I pitched it to some traditional publishers. And they thought that some of the traditional publishers thought it was too niche, and that men's studies wasn't necessarily a hot market, which is the way it was getting classified. And so I started reaching out to people. As you can probably tell, I'm not shy. And so I reached out to Scribe Media in Austin, Texas, to JT McCormick, who's the CEO there, and told him what my story was, and JT offered support, so it was published through Lion's Crest, which is the Scribe Media imprint, and so that's why I say it was hybrid, because Scribe, you know, I have all of the rights but Scribe did the editing, they did the cover design and the artwork. And they helped me with the marketing of the book, and I don't have an affiliate marketing position with them or anything of that nature. But I tell you what, everybody that I worked with at Scribe was just golden. And you mentioned Jay Thorne. I was reading one of Jay's blogs, and at the bottom of his blog, I saw a Cleveland Heights address, and I thought, whoa, Cleveland Heights? Well, that's 10 miles from me, right? 15 miles. So I wrote a note to the email that he had on the blog, and I said, hey, dude, if you're real and you really have a place in Cleveland Heights, I live in Chagrin Falls, so, you know, I'm like 10, 15 miles. If you'd like to get together for coffee sometime, you know, I'd love to meet you. And about 2 days later, I got a response that said, hey, Mark, this is Jay. I am real. I do live in the Cleveland Heights area, so yeah, coffee would be cool. So I have made a good friend in Jay,
I'll jump in. If anybody listening doesn't know Jay, look Jay up. Jay Thorne, career author with Zach Bohannon. They have a great podcast. He has several podcasts. He has a lot of good advice out there, a lot of good books and blogs, and I also had written to him something. That's one of the things I've been finding, is that I think authors are way better and cooler than stars or actors, because they're more approachable.
Yes.
They don't get mobbed so much. Some of them do, obviously, but I was able to write several big name, quote unquote, big name authors, and I almost always get a reply. In fact, I met an author, Ian Douglas, and I was actually in his house for some event we were at, and didn't even know who he was, that he was an author, and I jumped right into a conversation he was having with another author about Stephen King, and, you know, just gave my two cents to these authors who have been doing it for 30 some years. And,
right.
And then everybody's like, hey, you do know that he's like a best-selling author. And I'm like, no way. So yeah, I definitely think authors are cooler, and I've had no qualms about reaching out to even big names at times. And I would definitely say Jay has some great advice and will definitely try and help you if he can.
Yes, he will. And I, you know, it's in my book, Conquering the Boundaries of Friendship, I talk about authenticity. And Jay is an authentic man. He doesn't sugarcoat it. He's very straightforward. He has tremendous advice on self-publishing and becoming a career author. And he has helped me immensely with even just providing encouragement on kind of sticking with it and sticking through the marketing program, because you know, for me personally, the writing was actually the easy part. It was the marketing and kind of positioning and those types of things that were tough for me, because I don't have a blog. It doesn't relate directly to my business, although I do personal and professional coaching. That the book, you know, isn't a door opener for those types of things. And
so are you doing all of that yourself, or do you have a company or a service that you're doing some through, or what are you doing for your marketing? How are you getting the word out, getting the book out there, et cetera?
Email. It's been through LinkedIn. I have about 8,000 connections on LinkedIn. And I am not a lion. A lion, for those of you listening, is a LinkedIn open networker, so someone who will accept an invitation from anybody. All 8,000 of those connections on LinkedIn are people that I personally know or have worked with, or they have been clients, or I have provided services to them. And I did an extract of all of the emails from LinkedIn. And I used an email service, and I sent out the Genius link from Amazon, and sent out a little blurb on the book and what it was about. And I got a tremendous response. As a matter of fact, when I posted to LinkedIn the cover of the book and said that the book was coming, and I gave a brief synopsis, in 2 weeks' time, I had over 10,000 views of that synopsis. Which was tremendous traction. So it wasn't just my 8,000 connections; it's their connections as well who were seeing my book cover. And so it's you know, that's been kind of the and then going into to local bookstores. We have a little bookstore in Chagrin Falls called Fireside Books. And I approached the owner about carrying my book, and she said gladly. You know, it's in a couple of the local bookstores, and they put a nice local author sticker on it. But, you know, I'm really happy to say that 10 days into my launch on Amazon, I became an Amazon number one bestseller.
Nice. Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you so much. It was oh my God, I cannot tell you, Steve, that was such a good feeling, because it was certainly not expected. And, you know, for, like I said, for 2018, because not only did I have brain surgery, but I lost both of my parents that year. Both of them passed away. So 2018 wasn't a banner year in my...
No, it doesn't sound like it.
...in my book. For my book, 2019 has just been spectacular. And like I said, the next two, as soon as I finish writing, I've got a fantastic editor that I met just by reaching out, who's a professor at the University of Washington in Bellingham, Washington. And he collaborated with me to edit Conquering the Boundaries of Friendship. And I acknowledge him. His name is Chaz Hoppe. Chaz is, you know, a wordsmith extraordinaire, and was a good editor. I mean, he really helped me to clarify some points, and you know, it's one of those things where, as a new author, than getting folks to leave reviews has been challenging.
What have you done to get people to try and get people to get reviews?
Well, I've sent out I think 50 or so free copies of my book to people, and just ask them to, here's a free copy of the book. If you would, when you read it, give me a review, but make it an honest review, which as I think Steve, I think everybody knows, reviews on Amazon are very strategically important for particularly a new author such as myself. And I have just been heartened by the reviews that I've gotten, and not just from the 50 or so that I sent out as free copies, but there are a number of reviews out there now who I have no idea who the people are. So they obviously bought the book and decided to leave a review. And then, as I said, I have ctbfbook@gmail.com. I've gotten a number of just incredibly encouraging notes and thanks for writing the book, and let us know when your next book comes out. And of course, I'm continuing to build my email list through that, so I can develop a readership. But unlike Jay and some other folks, I don't have the imagination to do fiction.
Well, it sounds like your nonfiction is pretty inspiring. I unfortunately, I have not gotten it. I'm going to have to get your book and read it. I know you were talking about it at the weekend retreat, which is what made me think of you for this podcast. So you've definitely intrigued me on wanting to read your book.
Well, thank you, Steve. It's been fun to write, and it's been so incredibly rewarding. And
You already said you're working on your next book. What have you learned from this first one that you're doing different for the next one?
Starting marketing the book sooner, because I didn't really do any marketing of any type until the book was actually published. So I'm going to start getting the word out, particularly since this next one is about patients and caregivers. Reaching out to a number of hospitals that have therapy programs, reaching out to a number of charities, because, again, in doing the research for the book, there isn't a heck of a lot of material out there that is written for caregivers or patients who have experienced traumatic physical injury to their bodies. There's a lot of academic things out there, but there's nothing certainly that's been written by patients for patients. That's something that I'm definitely doing differently.
Okay, so along those lines, what advice would you give other authors? I mean, you've already said several things you've done that I think other authors may be extremely helpful for, but is there anything else you would give advice to other authors who are working on their first book?
Yes, I would say do your research. Read as much as you can in the genre that you are writing in, whether it be fiction or whether it be nonfiction or whether it be post-apocalyptic fiction or whether it be romance novels, whatever. Read as much as you can in those genres and look at what other authors do. And just remember, they are not your competition. I learned that very early on. Initially I was thinking about some of the authors that are out there as being my competition, but they are not. As a matter of fact, they're certainly in my case, they're pioneers in leading the way so that an author such as myself can come in with something like Conquering the Boundaries of Friendship and have an interest group or having a readership out there that's already established. So I would say do your research and learn as much as you can about the Amazon keywords. And one of the things that I do, and I did for the first book, interestingly, and this is not since I've become an author, I've done this as a sales guy for years. I do what I call an avatar. Who is my ideal reader? Who is it that I expect to be reading my material? And I try to get into as much detail as I possibly can. And as a sales guy, I always did an avatar for who was the beneficiary of the particular service that I was offering to my client, because my client may be the buyer, but they're not the beneficiary. And so as an author, I do an avatar of what my ideal reader looks like, age-wise, demographics, educational level, as much detail as I can. And I keep that avatar in my mind as to who I'm writing the book for and who my ideal reader is. And I find that personally it's kind of my North Star, if you will, when I start thinking about, should I construct a chapter one particular way. I keep in mind who my ideal reader is and who I'm trying to provide the most benefit with my book, and that helps me to keep that direction, right? And I think of it as the difference between a compass and a roadmap. A compass gives you direction. A roadmap tells you how to get from point A to point B. Right. And those avatars are my compass. They keep me going in the direction that I want to go.
And I've heard that before too. I've heard others say, "You're figure out your reader." And then people are like, "Well, I don't know who my reader is." And, you know, but you do, especially for a book like yours, you have an idea of who would benefit. And as you have found out, even if you're targeting, let's say, middle-aged men that live in big cities, you get a whole variety. You get people from down south, up north, from across the seas. You get women. You get younger men, older men. So it doesn't stop you and limit your book from being discovered by others, but by focusing on that one particular group that's your avatar, then you're more popular, so it actually helps your book be discovered by others, and from what I've seen.
Yes, and I would suggest that was certainly true with Conquering the Boundaries of Friendship, and that avatar for your Cured is giving me some ideas on, again, opportunities for me to go out to market the next book and to start that marketing well in advance of its publication date. So, you know, kind of preceding the marketplace, if you will, so that people know what's coming, and again, continuing to build that email list, because I'm not a social media maven by any stretch of the imagination, but interestingly, if you keep your mind open to opportunities, whether you're older or younger, if you kind of check your baggage at the door, you can open yourself to a world of opportunities, and a world of opportunities as far as friendship is concerned. But similarly with authoring, if you keep your mind open about opportunities that you have as you're writing and seeking advice, coaching, mastermind groups, it's a phenomenal world. And I have to echo the same commentary that you made earlier, Steve, is I have been embraced by a number of authors, and the authors that I've reached out to have been just so generous with their time, their support, their coaching, and or challenging me, asking me questions of, have you thought about X, Y, or Z, that I've been just totally blown away by how embracing and how open the author community is to having a new author such as myself, be as in their community, and I feel that it's a community that's very warm and embracing, And that would be my other bit of advice to people. If you're a great fiction author, or you have a concept that you want to try out, give it a shot. But stick with what you know. Creatively telling your story, and even though it's in my case with nonfiction, it's a true story that you're telling, but telling it in such a way that it's of interest to the readers, and you know, gets to be a page turner where someone wants to find out what happens next. Doesn't mean you can't be creative with how you construct your work.
Right. And I've heard a lot about that with nonfiction, writing the story, writing it
yes.
to tell the story. I need to get going. I'm sure you yep. do too. Where can we find your book besides Amazon? And do you have a website? Is there any other places online we can find you?
You can find me on LinkedIn. I'm Mark J. Roman on LinkedIn. And I am establishing an author's website as we speak. And it's just markroman-author.com. And then for Conquering the Boundaries, you can find me at CTBF book, one word, Conquering the Boundaries of Friendship book at gmail.com. And of course, my book is available on Amazon.com, on Barnes & Noble. And it's also been picked up by about 150 Barnes & Noble brick-and-mortar stores.
Oh, nice.
But I would also suggest if you think you're going to get it at a local physical Barnes & Noble, check out whether they have inventory in that particular store. Because I know a couple of friends have written to me and said, we stopped at our local Barnes & Noble and they didn't have your book, but they ordered it for us. So I don't know how Barnes & Noble distribution network works on that, certainly Amazon.com, and it's available in e-reader formats, and it's also available in paperback on Amazon and BarnesandNoble.com. And then in Europe, interestingly enough, there's a and I don't remember what it's but it's basically a spin-off of Aldi, the grocery chain here in the States. There's an Aldi in Germany who is also carrying my book. I'm not quite sure how they picked it up. They weren't in my original distribution plan, but I've got a friend, a doctor friend, who used to be a colleague of mine, and we don't work together any longer, but he sent me a fantastic email and said, Mark, I was able to buy your book at Aldi.
Wow.
And I kind of chuckled and said, Aldi is the grocery chain. And he said, no, not in Germany. And he lives in Frankfurt, in Wiesbaden. And so I'm not quite sure how it got picked up in some of those other geographies, but, it's fine with me. As I said, my objective with the book is to try to help as many individuals, men and women, as possible to have deep, meaningful relationships. And as I said earlier, I'm a contrarian when it comes to keeping your personal and your professional lives separate. I think that they can coexist and co-mingle quite well. So, well, Steve, it's been a pleasure.
Yes. It's been great talking to you. I appreciate the time, Mark.
Yeah,
and
no worries.
All the great words of wisdom and advice.
Well, thank you. Okay, great, Steve. You take care of yourself. Cheers.
Thanks, you too, sir.
Or have a Merry Christmas.
You too. Enjoy the holidays.
Yep, thanks, Steve. Bye now.
Thank you for listening to Discovered Wordsmiths. Come back next week and listen to another author discuss the road they've traveled, and maybe, sometime in the near future, it might be you.